Good. So welcome back. Let's continue. So in the first part, right, we've seen that there's these three problems, negative triangle, min plus matrix multiplication, and APSP, all of which do not seem to admit faster algorithms than n cubed. So people came up with this APSP hypothesis, which states that APSP specifically cannot be solved faster than n cubed time. Now in the second part of this lecture, we'll actually see that this hypothesis implies also that negative triangle and min plus matrix multiplication cannot be solved faster than n cubed, and in fact that it's equivalent to saying that negative triangle cannot be solved faster than n cubed. Okay, so we'll see like a sequence of subcubic equivalences between these three problems. And then in the next part of the lecture, Mia's gonna show you even more subcubic equivalences, and then on the exercise sheet, you're gonna do even more subcubic equivalences. So it's really worked out great in the end for a lot of problems. Okay. So today, let me just write it once time explicitly, negative triangle is subcubic equivalent to min plus matrix multiplication, which is subcubic equivalent to APSP. Let me put a reference here. This is due to Vasilevska Williams. And Williams from 13. Okay, now before I go into the technical details, here's at least a hint why this reduction seems very surprising at first. Note that APSP is a problem which has a lot of outputs, right? You have to compute something for n squared pairs of nodes. You have to compare compute the distance, which is like a number of, say, log n bits. So the output size of APSP is something like n squared log n, really big. Whereas the output for negative triangle is a single bit. Is there a negative triangle? Now, how can it possibly be true that a problem with a lot of output bits can be equivalent to a problem with just a single output bit? Because it doesn't seem feasible at all to have like, how would a fast algorithm for negative triangle that just gives you like one bit ever lead to an algorithm for APSP? So that's kind of the conceptual challenge that we'll approach through the course of this lecture. But let's do it step by step. And the first step is a step which actually many of you will probably now not be surprised about, at least not a lot. So how, or maybe actually, yeah, before we start, I do not want to talk about the simple directions. Let me just put it here like as an exercise. You know, convince yourself of the easy directions, which is these directions, right? Negative triangles should be easier than min plus matrix multiplication, it's easier than the APSP. Very similar to the rule of reductions we've seen for the unweighted variance before. We'll talk about the other directions, reducing APSP to min plus matrix multiplication, reducing this to negative triangle. And in this chain of reductions, maybe the first step should be reducing APSP to min plus matrix product. Okay. A couple of you have already said it before. What's the important keyword here? Repeated squaring, exactly. If you haven't heard that before, don't worry at all. Not necessary to understand this. You're just gonna learn it. Okay, the idea is this. We wanna compute all pair, like the distance between all pairs of nodes in the graph, and let A be the adjacency matrix of that graph. What does this mean? Formally, well, the ij entry, maybe let me write it as the ik entry of this matrix is defined as, well, 0 if I equals k. So the diagonals are 0. It's the weight of the edge from I to k, if there is an edge from I to k. And it's infinity otherwise. course, infinity is not really an integer, so we'll maybe have to worry about some details in the end, but for now, let's pretend it's infinity. Okay? So then there's a very simple algorithm to compute the distances. And it goes like this. So you start with a matrix A0, which is just A. And then you repeat the following thing L times, log N times, sorry. Compute the matrix AL to be the square of the matrix AL minus 1, but with respect to the min plus product. And in the end, we claim that the distances from some node I to j is actually just the entry of the matrix, the final matrix, in the position I and j. Okay? Why should this be correct? The idea is basically this, or the proof is that you inductively show that the AL matrix, the ijth entry, stores exactly the distance from I to j, which uses at most 2 to the L hops. Okay, so let me write it down formally once, but this notation should mean it's the distance, the length, the shortest path from I to j that is only allowed to take 2 to the I hops. Prove this, then the statement is clear. Because then it would mean that if you go to like the final matrix, the log n matrix, this would store the distances of all paths which take it up to 2 to the log n, so up to n hops. But clearly, any shortest path can take at most n hops, because then it has visited every vertex in the graph. OK? So to prove this, we have to consider two cases, I guess. The first one is, what if L is equal to 0? Well, if L is equal to 0, we have to show that the matrix A0, which is just the adjacency matrix, stores the distances of all paths of length at most 1. Right? That's pretty obvious, because any shortest path, any path with length at most 1 either has length 0, and I and k are the same, or it has length 1, and you take exactly one edge of this book. And the alternative, if L is bigger than that, so for this, the following picture helps. So suppose you have any shortest path from I to j, which uses at most 2 to the L hops. Right? Then in particular, there must be a middle point on that path, such that the path to the left and the path to the right have at most 2 to the L minus 1 hops. This segment has 2 to the L minus 1 hops, and this segment has at most 2 to the L minus 1 hops. OK? Let me denote this middle point by k. Good. Then, well, OK, I guess I'm moving further and further to the left. In words, or in math, this means there exists some k such that the 2 to the L hop distance from I to j is just equal to the 2 to the L minus 1 hop distance from I to k plus
plus the 2 to the L minus 1 hop distance from K to J. And on the other hand, we have that for all K, no matter what is the middle point you choose there, it is always true that this distance is at most the distance from I to K plus the distance from K to J. Okay, does that make sense? There is a good middle point, namely you really take the shortest path and you take the point in the middle. And on the other hand, no matter what middle point you choose, you will only find a detour. You will never find a shorter path. Right? But now the statement is just extremely obvious. And I just say, well then, AL of I and J, this is the min plus product of two matrices, which by definition is just, you know, the minimum over all K, AL minus 1 of I and K, plus AL minus 1 from K to J, which by induction is the minimum over all K to the L minus 1 distance from I to K plus the 2 to the L minus 1 distance from K to J. And now, using the observations we've written here before, right? If you choose the correct minimum, you get exactly the distance. And if you choose the wrong K, you will get something which is bigger than that. So really, by taking the minimum here, you really get the proper 2 to the L hop distance from I to J. OK? It's a lot of math for the simple statement that, you know, you can repeatedly square the adjacency matrix to compute the distance via longer and longer hop paths. Any questions about the first part? Good. Now let's move on. I guess it's time to remove matrix multiplication. I see. Well, okay. What I'm claiming to prove here is a subcubic reduction, right? APSP reduces like with this subcubic reduction arrow to this. So the formal statement we're proving is, if there is a subcubic algorithm, meaning O to the O of n to the 3 minus epsilon time algorithm for APSP, sorry, for min plus product, then there is an n to the 3 minus epsilon prime algorithm for APSP. Now, what this algorithm shows is actually there's even an n to the 3 minus epsilon log n algorithm. But the log n doesn't matter because you can just make the epsilon a little bit smaller. Right? So indeed, the reduction as we want to prove it is formally correct without adding any O tildes anywhere. Does that make sense? Okay.
For this one, are you going to do binary search?
You're way ahead. Yeah. Good one. But we have to do it a little bit careful. Actually, the way I'd like to think about it, we're going to introduce a third problem, like another intermediate problem, and reduce to that one first. And for this, indeed, we will use something like binary search. OK, so let me introduce a fourth problem, which is called all edges. All edges negative triangle.
Okay, in this problem, the setup is very similar. You're still given a tripartite graph with weights. The input is the same as for a negative triangle. And you still have weights. But the task is now not to compute, not to test whether there is a negative triangle in the graph, but you have to decide for every edge whether it is in a negative triangle. OK, so for each edge, decide if E is in a negative triangle. OK, let's take this as an intermediate problem. And we'll also prove that these problems are subcubic equivalent to this one. Right? So the natural next step would be to prove that we've already shown that APSP reduces to min plus product, min plus matrix multiplication. So now we're going to show that min plus matrix multiplication reduces to this problem. And this is exactly, for this, it's exactly correct. We're going to use something which looks like binary search. In fact, maybe the name that may be denoted by, abbreviated by all edge negative triangle, OK. The name which maybe suits this variant, it's called parallel binary search. Right, and the intuition is exactly correct. Basically, negative triangles, you know, it gives you like, okay, fix an edge in, think of this as the tripartite graph, right? Fix any pair ij. We want to know, this is basically what min plus product is about, what is the shortest two path from I to j? So if you can put an arbitrary edge here and test whether the triangle which is closed by this edge is negative, you can get like some information about the shortest path, basically like one bit in its bit representation, essentially. So it does make sense to think about binary search in the way that we're going to adapt the weights in this edge part to search step by step for the proper value of the shortest path. But the important thing is, we have to compute it for all pairs I and j at the same time. Right? This is why we call it parallel binary search, so that you actually discover, you don't just binary search for one edge at a time. This would give you like an overhead of n squared times the original running time, which is way too much, of course. Good. So with parallel binary search, actually turns out you can do it in parallel. OK. I think it's good to see this also formally. So I'll be formal again. So the idea is, I mean, similarly, basically, whenever you have binary search, right, you maintain something like a search interval. Just this time, we have to maintain a search interval for all pairs ij. Let me denote the search interval basically by the lower bound lij and the upper bound uij. Lower bound included, upper bound excluded. Where we want to, you know, want to guarantee that the min plus product of I and j is indeed contained in this interval. And then with log n calls to all edges negative triangle, we want to make these intervals smaller and smaller and smaller until in the end they only contain one point, which is the true solution. OK? And for this, consider the following algorithm. How would you initialize the intervals? Actually,
can you write a little bit bigger?
Oh, sorry, yes, I'll try.
Or use the other
Oh, that is already the other chalk. Okay, yeah, let me start over here. So you initialize the search intervals to be basically the smallest value that could take, which is something like minus 2w, when w is the largest entry in the matrices in absolute value. And you initialize the upper bounds with 2 times the largest entry. Now, clearly, the min plus product will be between these two numbers. OK? And then you repeat the following log 4w times. We create this graph. Construct this graph where all edges are present, so it's a complete graph. And where we assign the edge weights as follows.
Can you move the board up?
I can, but then I can't really draw anymore. Let's see. Okay, so we construct a tripartite graph where the edges from here to here, let's say from a node I to a node K. Can you read this?
No.
Not at all. Maybe this one. Can you read this?
Yes.
OK. So the edges on this part are just the weights of the matrix, the entries of the matrix AIK. The edges to the right are the entries of the matrix B. OK? And the edges from I to J, make them red, will be labeled by Mij, where Mij is the midpoint of the search interval. So it's Lij plus Uij half. OK? Now, the insight is that I don't really want to erase all this shortest path. Do you remember the definition of IPSP? All of you? OK. I think it's time to erase it. Well, the insight is simply that we can update now the search interval to be either Lij to Mij or to Mij to Uij, depending on whether the edge ij is a negative triangle. Not at all. Good. First condition.
It's getting too fine-grained
for us. OK, so you update the search interval either by saying you go like from the left to the midpoint if ij was in a negative triangle, or from the midpoint to the right if ij was not a negative triangle. Right? And the proof is very simple. You know, basically, what you have to observe is that
There's a chain of equivalent statements. Right? So ij being in a negative triangle well, this is equivalent to saying that there is some node k such that the weight from I to k plus the weight from k to j plus the weight from I to j is negative. Sure, that's just the definition. Which is, however, equivalent, putting our specific weights. Oh, by the way, I think I made a mistake. Sorry. This is supposed to be minus mij. It's important. You already observed it. Great. So by definition, this is just, well, if there is a k such that aik, which is the by definition the edge wik, plus bkj, which is the definition of the edge from k to j, minus mij is less than 0, right? Or by rearranging this, whether the aik plus bkj is less than mij. OK, perfect. And that's exactly what we're going to prove after all, right? If it's in a negative triangle, we can reduce the search interval to mij. If it isn't, well, then it's at least mij, so we can set the lower bound of the search interval to mij. And in any case, after log of 4w iterations, all the search intervals have size at most 1. We have that basically. Right? So in particular, the first part is just equal to the lower part, the lower end of the search interval. OK? This completes step 2. Any questions about that? Good? Finally, the third part. This is really the magic part. I think like when I first learned about fine grain complexity, this was maybe the part which excited me the most about the entire thing. It's more technical stuff went on. This is so easy and still so incredibly cool. So maybe you should think about it before we start with the technical details. So far, we have massaged the problem around a lot, right? We have we got rid of the property that you have to deal with graphs and paths of arbitrary length. We got rid of the fact that you have to actually compute the precise number. Now you only have to decide whether it's negative or non-negative. But we still are left with the problem, namely all edges negative triangle, in which you have to compute n squared outputs, something for every edge, right? N squared bits. But we want to say that negative, like all edges negative triangle, reduces to negative triangle, a problem which only has one output bit. Do you have any idea how that should be possible? Like obviously the clear approach that you just create, like you take your instance and you create another instance of negative triangle, this cannot work, right? You just produce one output bit after all. How would you deal with that?
I'm not trying to double the number of output bits every time.
Say it again, please.
Double the number of output bits?
OK, yeah, how would you do it? Do you have a concrete idea?
Something like building the graph indefinitely?
Well, it's going in the right direction. I mean, you're not doing something on the original graph. You have to do something on another graph. Now, if you want, I'll give you one more minute. Any more ideas how we can generate more output bits? Any ideas?
Try
to what?
Somehow batch pairs of vertices. So instead of giving you information about one particular pair having a triangle, at the time you try to get information about, like, they give you two sets, and there's a triangle between any negative triangle between any.
Okay. So in some sense, this is like a big batching problem, sure, right? You want to give an output for every edge, but then if you batch all of them together, this is just going to tell you is there one for which the answer is yes. So of course, in some sense, that's correct. But I think the question is, like, the problem is just how do you get rid of this batching in the end? Even if you have a more fine-grained one, you somehow have to, you know, somehow have to be able to answer specific queries while only being able to ask batch queries. Yes. Yes.
Make sure that you start with all the weights being positive, and then add shortcut edges with negative weights between all pairs of edges of all pairs of vertices, and binary search when it gets negative.
Okay. In principle, doesn't sound bad, but the thing is still you're fighting against the output issue,
yeah.
Right? With every call to the oracle, like let's say you start from one big graph, and you reduce it to another big graph. Like this is an all edge negative triangle instance. This is just a negative triangle instance, right? If we attempt to do something like this, well, then the reduction will only give you one output bit. You need n squared output bits, though, right? So you have to repeat this basically n squared times. And then the reduction would be way too inefficient. Yes. Okay, but like what you said is if there's log n squared many calls,
right.
Each of those gives you one output bit though, then you only learn log many output bits, right? So maybe you should clarify, like if you, like every output bit is extremely valuable, right? Say I give you a graph and I already point you to some log n negative triangles in the graph. Does it tell you anything about the other negative triangles? It really doesn't, right? Like I could just take them out, say, well, you are a part of negative triangle, but you're still left with the entire problem to begin with, maybe just log n negative triangles missing. So it is really like you have n squared valuable output bits, and you cannot really cheat by saying, well, you only compute log n of them or something. You really have to compute all of them.
Many small instances?
Yes, very nice, good. Well, we can afford, we want n squared instances, right? Now, we cannot afford to build a big one. So what we should do is we should create very small instances of negative triangle. Okay? That might work. If they're sufficiently small, you might be able to get away with n squared calls. Like if all of these calls just take something like linear time. Good. So let's Let's stay on the conceptual level for a bit. Here's a way to split a graph. Maybe let me draw it a little bit bigger. This is the given instance of all edges triangle, right? You have some edges here, and some edges there. Now, one way of splitting the graph into smaller instances is to say we just split all the vertex parts into smaller groups. For each triple of groups, let's say maybe maybe this one, this one, and this one, right? You consider only the sub-instance induced by these node parts. We can now afford to ask, is there a negative triangle in these parts? Like this is basically what's our intention behind the whole thing, right? We want to say the small instance, now this is feasible.
OK, that's great. So maybe the instance tells us there's a negative triangle in there. So maybe we remember that this was a negative triangle, and maybe we just remove it by, say, removing an edge from the graph or something. Still, then, we have to kind of repeat everything for every node part. So say we split this into g groups. So we have g cubed calls, right? But inside every part, we still have to discover basically all triangles. And inside every part, there could be, if we assume that all of these nodes, all of these have roughly the same size, namely n over g, there could be n over g cubed many triangles. So n cubed over g cubed triangles, sorry, yeah. Per subgraph. So now, if per subgraph you would have to find all n cubed by g cubed many triangles, you would still end up with cubic time. Does that make sense? Do you see any way around this?
You do this inductively, and once you get it for one group, you make them into one vertex.
Okay.
And for each pair, like within two groups, you just keep the minimum edge weight.
I think you might be losing triangles that way. Like if you compress these two into just one edge, well, then there might be some. Right. Any other suggestions? Yes?
So you don't really have to cover the triangle. I mean, for each edge in the group from B to C, you check whether that's a triangle.
Uh-huh.
This is in the triangle by removing everything. that is a very, very long way of thinking. For example, you remove everything from B to C,
okay.
And you keep on that edge, and you keep running that way.
So do I understand correctly? What you're saying is you only care about edges instead of triangles. I think you're on the right way. Correct me if I'm wrong, but if what you're saying is the following, then you're correct. If you're saying, well, we don't really have to detect all triangles in this graph. After all, we only care about the fact whether every edge is in a triangle. Well, then basically we could hope to get away not with listing all triangles, but in total listing at most n squared triangles. Because we only care about every edge, there's at most n squared edges in total. Once, right? Triangle for every edge. Which would be much fewer than n cubed triangles. Does that make sense? Now we're going to put these two ideas together, and then it's going to work. But again, because this is so wonderful, let me be formal about it. So step three. If you want to give a name to this reduction, even though it's not exactly absolutely accurate, this is sometimes also called a self-reduction. Is you kind of reduce a problem to itself on smaller instances. It's good to keep in mind. OK. The first step is this. We partition the node parts. Recall that we call the node parts x, y, and z. We partition them into equal-sized blocks, arbitrarily. These have size at most n over g. Then let me also write g, I, j, k for the subgraph of g induced by x, I, y, j, c, k. Okay, so in the picture over there, this is just the orange subgraph. This will be a graph G, I, J, K.
Now, do the following thing. For all triples ijk, you do the following thing. While gijk contains a negative triangle, this is like a loop, this is another loop, you find a negative triangle. X, Y, Z in the graph GIJK. Then you report yes for the edge XZ, and you remove the edge XC altogether. The important thing is we're going to remove it from all graphs GIJK. Okay? And if you insist, then in the end you report no for all other edges. So what I should mention here is actually a remark. This algorithm only, in this algorithm, we only care about the edges. The edges in between the vertex parts x and z. You can also care about the other vertex parts. We're running this algorithm 3 times for all the other edge parts. But only focus on the edges in X and Z right now. And the claim is that this algorithm is indeed correct. This entire algorithm. Whatever. OK. Now, yes?
I might be missing something, so, but why not? Why couldn't you just, instead of running it 3 times, report yes for all?
You could report yes for all 3 edges, but the issue is that you cannot remove all 3 edges from the graph. It's a little bit subtle, but basically what can happen is you might remove an edge which is relevant for another triangle that way. But if you only remove edges from one edge part, you really can make sure that you will never need this edge again in the rest of the graph. I'll get back to it. Actually, yeah, let me quickly talk about correctness of this algorithm, and then I'll get back to it. So I claim this algorithm is obviously correct. Like, I don't want to write more than just, you know, correct. Because what are you doing? Well, every negative triangle is contained in some subgraph gijk. That's just the definition, right? We partitioned the original graph in a way that every node appears in one part, xi or yj or zk. In particular, every negative triangle appears in one such subgraph. So whatever that subgraph is, when you reach it in the loop, we're going to repeatedly extract negative triangles from that subgraph until we find our negative triangle, and then we are going to report yes for the edge. The only case which could happen is that the edge is no longer in the graph, but then we have already reported yes for it. Okay? So the graph definitely reports all edges, and in the end it says no for all the remaining ones, which are not in the triangle. Okay, so the correctness is clear. The magic is about the running time. Yes. Oh, yeah, good question. So, the correctness is obvious if you assume that you have an algorithm for finding negative triangles. I guess I want to write something here. Yeah, first step. Well, if negative triangle is in time n to the 3 minus epsilon, I claim that, well, then finding a negative triangle is in time n to the 3 minus epsilon. Maybe, because I'm generous, let me give you a log n, though it's not necessary. This is an exercise, but maybe you can just tell me how it works. Good. Or just half of the nodes, or whatever way exactly you binary search your way through there. It's exactly like what Amir has showed yesterday for threesomes. You know, deciding whether there's a threesome solution or finding a threesome solution, they're the same problem after all, up to some small tricks. Okay. Good. So if negative triangle is in time, n to the 3 minus epsilon, then also finding a negative triangle is in time, n to the 3 minus epsilon.
Yes, for like x, y, y.
Oh, OK, that's what I meant with this remark. In, for this algorithm, we only care about the edges between x and z. Then if you only care about the other edges, you just you rotate the graph, you view x and y now as the part xz, and you run this entire algorithm again. So if I run this algorithm 3 times, you will actually care. You will find all edges. OK, so let's analyze the running time of this. The magic or the key is really how many of these, how often do we find or test for a negative triangle in these small graphs? Right? So what's the number of negative triangle calls? And I claim that's exactly what we discussed before, right? You have to do it once for every group triple. For every group triple ijk, we definitely, well, just at the beginning of this while loop already, we test, is there a negative triangle in this subgraph? But then how often do you execute this line, finding a negative triangle? Sorry? Exactly. So at most, n squared times. So let me give them names. This is now line whatever A. This is line B. This is line A. This is why I had the labels before. Now I remember. OK. Right? For, this line is executed for every triple. But this line indeed is only executed most n squared times, because for each time you execute it, you remove an edge afterwards. And clearly, if you have removed all edges, you will never execute it again. OK? Yes?
It might be worth no, but then I guess the point is it reports no more than you
You mean at the very end it reports no? Or what do you mean?
Sorry.
Yeah, sorry, this is outside the loops. Yeah. OK, so then the total running time is what? Well, you have g cubed plus n squared calls to the negative triangle algorithm, which, as we know, runs in time n to the 3 minus epsilon. But that's exactly the inside, right? The groups are much smaller. The groups have size n by g now. So times n by g to the 3 minus epsilon. And now if you choose your g to be correctly, say we choose g to be n to the 1/3, sorry, n to the 2/3, let me maybe continue writing here. Then this becomes n squared times n to the 1/3 to the 3 minus epsilon, which is indeed n to the 3 minus epsilon 1/3. Right? Does that make sense? We choose g to be n to the 2/3 such that the number of calls, like both contributions to the number of calls become equal, namely n squared. But then the term which is remaining is just, so the groups now have size n to the 1/3. So calling our fast algorithm on them does actually something non-trivial. It's faster than time n to the 1 minus epsilon time. So you end up with a truly subcubic running time for negative, for all edges negative triangle. OK? that basically concludes the chain of reductions. Let me give you some takeaways here. So what have we done? We have we've seen this entire chain of reductions, which prove that APSP is equivalent to an easier and easier and easier problem until the very end. The easiest problem we came up with is negative triangle. What does that mean for you? Well, whenever you now want to prove APSP hardness reductions, you should not reduce APSP to your problem. You should reduce negative triangle to your problem. Because it's the easiest hard version, as, again, going back to Amir's talk from yesterday, right? It was this easiest hard problem equivalent to APSP was negative triangle. So the easiest, you're going to have the easiest time in your reductions whenever you start your reductions from negative triangle, just as a hint for the exercises. OK, then yes. Yes, absolutely. Yes.
This is a more general question, but like, it seems like a pattern that like decision problem is not that or search problems are not
that. Sorry, say it again.
Search problems don't seem to be much harder than decision problems.
Absolutely.
Is that like generally true? Like if I ever am like trying to do a loop of bottom, like should I not think about that too much, or are they kind of like?
Yes. You should not think about too much. Just spontaneously, I cannot come up with a single problem where they actually differ. Most of the time, you just do binary search. Yes?
Sorry, I have a question about the procedure here. So what if we have two negative triangles shared in an edge, and then you remove that shared edge?
OK. But the only case, the only thing which could happen is that you have two triangles like this, right? Here's some y. Maybe here's some y prime. Now, if I remove this edge, I might kill both of these triangles. But that's OK, because we really only want to report for every edge xz whether it is in a triangle. At least, you know, sorry, maybe I should have made that more explicit. But with a mark, I want to say, let's only care about the edges between x and z. If you cared about these edges too, then you would kill off some triangles, which you wouldn't want to kill. That's actually exactly the question from you in the beginning, right? That's why we only focus on one edge part first. We only remove edges from that edge part. Then the correctness is clear. OK? Any further questions? OK, not then. After the break, Amir is going to show you some hardness reductions based now on negative triangle. See you then.